I'd like to welcome everyone to our session this morning. We will be discussing new developments in treating HER2-positive metastatic breast cancer. I'm Christine Agius. I'm one of the nurse practitioners in breast oncology at Dana-Farber, and I will be your moderator today. I would like to start by introducing our presenters, both our medical oncologists in breast oncology at Dana-Farber, Dr. Ian Krop, who's been pioneering the development of new drugs for HER2-positive breast cancer for many years, and Dr. Heather Parsons, who has been working on developing blood tests to guide therapy for patients with breast cancer. And before we begin, I just want to review a few points in regards to how the session will work. The audience will not be able to speak or be heard during the presentations. Everyone will be muted. Questions can only be submitted through the Q&A box at the bottom of the screen. The chat function will be disabled. And feel free to submit questions during the presentations, and we will try and get to as many as we can in the allotted time. And also, we cannot address any personal clinical questions on this webinar. So I think we can start.
Okay. So Heather and I are both gonna tag team a little bit with our presentation. Actually, I don't have a good sense of how long the presentation is gonna be. I guess we'll find out. We'll try to get through the slides pretty quickly, and then we wanna have as much time as possible to answer your questions. We're very sorry we can't do this in person, hopefully next time. But we still wanna keep it very interactive. So please don't be shy, ask lots of questions, the tougher the better, and we'll do our best to answer them. So let me share. Slides, and we can get started. So I think Heather, you're going to start us off.
Yep, I am. And you'll do the slides.
Yep.
Perfect. So we always like to start by just backing up and thinking about metastatic breast cancer and make sure we're all starting on the same page. So a little bit of a 101, that breast cancer that's metastatic is breast cancer that's spread from the breast and lymph nodes to other areas of a patient's body, so beyond the breast and the lymph nodes. It usually occurs years after initial diagnosis and breast surgery, but some patients, and in HER2-positive breast cancer, this is important and relevant, that they can also have metastatic breast cancer when they're first diagnosed. And this is called sometimes de novo presentation. And in overall breast cancer, it's about 6%. In HER2-positive breast cancer, it's actually about 40 to 50%. Of metastatic breast cancer. Around 150,000 patients living with metastatic breast cancer in the United States right now. And fortunately, there are many treatments that are available for all forms of metastatic breast cancer. Next slide. But one important thing to know is that treatments are generally not curative. We hope that that's not always the case, and we'll talk a little bit about some work that's trying to maybe get at this a little bit. But right now that most treatments are thought to be non-curative for breast cancer. Next slide. So how do we treat metastatic breast cancer? This is sort of a general overview of how we think about it, and that we start out with a particular treatment that's directed at a specific patient's specific breast cancer through all sorts of ways that we learn about the breast cancer, whether it's the HER2 status, the hormone receptor status, the size and the where the breast cancer is. And we usually continue that therapy for the amount of time that it continues to work. And we figure that out by checking in with patients how they're feeling, any new symptoms, through scans, and sometimes through the use of tumor markers. And at some time when that therapy stops working, we have evidence that it stops working, then we step back again and think about another therapy and choose a different therapy to start on. And the goal of that therapy and of all of these therapies is to extend the amount of time that a patient has and also to provide a high quality of life. And we work together with all of the information that we have to guide that therapy. Next slide. In terms of breast cancer subtypes, These are the sort of the major three groups, and there are other ways to break this down, but generally speaking in clinic, we think about that most breast cancer is hormone receptor positive and HER2 negative. That makes up about 2/3 of breast cancer. HER2 positive breast cancer makes up about another 15% when we're thinking about metastatic breast cancer, and triple negative breast cancer, when we're thinking about metastatic breast cancer, it makes up about 25 to 30%. Next slide, please. So what is HER2 and why are we all here today to talk about HER2? Well, it's actually, and this is a nice artist's drawing of what the HER2 is, but it's a cell surface signaling protein. So most cells or many cells in the body have this on the cell surface. It has a part that's outside of the cell, the extracellular component and intracellular component inside the cell. And when it binds to another HER2 protein, then it can signal to the cell to continue growing and surviving. And so it's a normal part of a cell. Next slide. But on normal cells or normal breast cancer cells, you can see, or breast cells, not breast cancer cells, there are fewer than 10,000 copies of HER2 on that breast cancer cell. But in the case of breast cancer cells, next slide, please. They have about maybe 2 million copies of HER2 proteins that are just driving that cell to grow. And so this is really the a dramatic overexpression of HER2 proteins and causing the cell to driving the cancer to grow. Next slide, please. So one really interesting and wonderful scientific development was a development of trastuzumab or Herceptin, which is now more than 20 years ago, which was the development of an antibody to target the HER2 protein, so that it could target that and then bring the immune system to attack the breast cancer, and it was a very significant improvement in patients, how patients did. Next slide. So I'll hand it over to Ian here to talk a little bit about trastuzumab and other drugs we use to treat HER2 positive breast cancer.
Sorry to interrupt. I just got a message saying the slides were not moving forward.
Oh.
I don't know. I'm not having a problem seeing them, but can the person who wrote in that they were having trouble, can you see them now? Okay. All right. Looks like it's okay now. Sorry.
Okay. It may be that one
the delay sometimes.
Their computer froze or something.
Okay.
Thanks for anybody else having trouble, let us know. We want to make sure everybody can see everything. As Heather said, the breakthrough was understanding that the reason these cancers were basically cancers was because they were being driven by this HER2 protein, and the development of a drug like trastuzumab or Herceptin that blocked that HER2 protein led to some real benefits. And what was shown is that they tested this drug in the clinic in patients with HER2 positive metastatic disease. And they did a trial where they combined chemotherapy with trastuzumab, and they compared it with patients who got chemotherapy alone. And it was found that when you added the trastuzumab, it made the chemotherapy work substantially better. So essentially it doubled how well the chemotherapy worked, how long the chemotherapy worked to control the patient's cancer before it started to progress. So it was a real substantial improvement in how patients were doing by adding this drug to chemotherapy. And the nice thing was, because that trastuzumab is so exquisitely targeted to HER2, it doesn't bind to anything else in the body, the side effects of adding trastuzumab were pretty minimal. Really, the only thing that we watch for is that in rare cases, adding trastuzumab can cause damage to a person's heart. Obviously, that's a serious thing, but fortunately, it's quite rare, and we can monitor for it. And usually, if it happens, it happens within the first year or so of the use of drugs like trastuzumab. So if people don't have a problem with their heart after the first year, it's pretty unlikely that it's going to happen after that. But certainly something that we all keep in mind whenever we're using these kinds of drugs. But overall, a real dramatic benefit in terms of how people were doing with adding this particular drug, trastuzumab, which again blocks HER2 and also activates the immune system, as Heather mentioned. But even though this was a pretty substantial improvement, eventually, in most people, the cancer figures out a way to get around the effects of trastuzumab and can start to grow again. And we call that resistant disease. Now, of course, we want to know why that happens. And you know, the picture that Heather mentioned or showed you, the cartoon where it looks like there's HER2 on the surface of the cell and it sends this kind of lightning bolt signal into the cell. Of course, in real life, it's more complicated than that. And you know, cancers actually have multiple different kind of what we call signaling pathways that they use to kind of drive their growth. And so over time, what happens is the cancer figures out a way to get around that one pathway and starts to use other pathways. The HER2 is still relevant, but it's not this one pathway that trastuzumab blocks is not enough to stop the cancer from growing at that point. And it starts to grow again. And again, we call that resistance. So of course, we need to figure out ways to get around that. And that led to the development of new drugs that hopefully can get around or can restore the cancer's sensitivity to treatment. And so what we do in the clinic in HER2-positive disease is kind of the same as Heather mentioned for all breast cancers, but instead of just switching from one treatment to another, we switch from one HER2 targeted treatment to another, because again, HER2 still is important for these cells. It's just they figured out a way to get around one drug, but not necessarily getting around another drug. So what we do is if a patient develops resistance to a drug like trastuzumab, we just switch to a different HER2 therapy and keep doing that. And oftentimes, that's a very effective way of controlling this kind of cancer for a long time. So what are some of the other HER2 targeted therapies that have been developed? Well, the first one beyond trastuzumab was a drug that's very similar to trastuzumab, and that's called pertuzumab, which you may know of as Perjeta. And so as you can kind of see in this picture, again, it's kind of a little bit of a silly cartoon, but it makes the point that the drugs are very similar. They both are what we call antibodies, which are very specific for HER2. They both bind to HER2, but they bind in slightly different ways. And by binding in different ways and combining the two of them together, you're able to block that HER2 signaling a little better than just with trastuzumab alone. And in the clinic, that pretty small difference actually leads to a substantial improvement in how well the drugs work. So when you add pertuzumab or Perjeta to chemotherapy and trastuzumab, you improve survival by another 30% on top of the 50% that we already saw with trastuzumab. Pertuzumab has a little bit more side effects than trastuzumab. We do see diarrhea pretty commonly with pertuzumab, and some people can get a rash as well, but these are generally pretty manageable and don't usually lead to problems such that we have to stop the drug. So overall, again, by targeting HER2 very specifically, we're able to improve the effectiveness of our treatment without adding a whole lot of side effects, which of course is our goal. But then, the success of drugs like trastuzumab and pertuzumab, it kind of really made it clear that HER2 is a target that really can lead to big benefits in terms of therapies. And so there's been this big, huge effort in developing new HER2 targeted therapies. And it's really paid off in a number of ways. And I think the first big kind of breakthrough after trastuzumab was this drug called T-DM1 or Kadcyla. And T-DM1 was a new class of drug, a new completely different type of drug that hadn't really been developed before, and it's called an antibody drug conjugate. And the idea here is that we take advantage of the ability of these antibodies to go through the body and find all the HER2 on the cancer cells, but not just use it to block HER2, but also to carry chemotherapy with it. Because as I mentioned before, adding chemotherapy and trastuzumab together is much more effective than trastuzumab by itself. But of course, when you use chemotherapy, you get all the side effects of chemotherapy because the chemotherapy goes everywhere. It's not specific to the cancer cell like trastuzumab is. So by combining chemotherapy and trastuzumab in one molecule, you kind of get the best of both worlds, or at least that was the idea. So TDM1 is basically trastuzumab. That's actually the T in TDM1, but it's linked to a chemotherapy. The DM1 is a chemotherapy. And the way this works, and I'm just going to come up with just yet another cartoon, is the TDM1 binds to HER2, just like trastuzumab does, because again, it partly is trastuzumab. But then rather than just block HER2, the whole thing gets brought inside the cell. And then once it's inside the cell, the chemotherapy part, the little orange stars there, get broken off, and then they go right into the cell where they can, you know, where they can kill the cell. So again, the idea of these antibody drug conjugates is that you're able to use the antibody to specifically deliver the chemotherapy right to the cancer cell. And hopefully that means not only are you able to kill the cancer cell with this very potent chemotherapy, but you hopefully can cut down the side effects because the chemotherapy is going where the antibody is taking it, not so much hitting normal tissues, and which is what causes the side effects. So that was the idea of these antibody drug conjugates. And it turns out that it worked very well in the clinic. When we look at TDM1 in patients who already had developed resistance, or their cancer had developed resistance to trastuzumab and chemotherapy, more than 40% of people had their cancer shrink really substantially with TDM1. And even more than that, had their cancer stop growing. And survival increased by another 30% when using TDM1. So again, a pretty big improvement. And because of the way it works, the side effects were pretty minimal. So you don't get the typical chemotherapy side effects for most people with TDM1. So people don't typically lose their hair. Nausea is pretty uncommon. And if it happens, it's pretty mild. And you don't usually get immune suppression, so people don't get infections on this drug. And you don't usually get a lot of that, what we call neuropathy or nerve injury, that you can get with some chemotherapy. You can get some decreases in certain laboratory things that we measure, like platelet counts and elevations of liver tests. But these usually don't cause side effects. And it's something that we just monitor. And if it's really starting to become a problem, we can cut down the dose of the TDM1. And that usually makes these problems go away. So for most people, TDM1 is a drug that's both effective and pretty well tolerated in terms of side effects. So this was felt to be a real success. And because it was so successful, it led to the idea, well, let's develop more of these antibody drug conjugates. And we're just in the last few years starting to see a kind of a real growth industry in the development of these antibody drug conjugates. And so the one that is now approved, it's a second generation conjugate, and it differs from TDM1 in a couple ways. One is that the chemotherapy that's used is different. So if a cancer has developed resistance to the chemotherapy that's used in TDM1, hopefully it won't be resistant to the chemotherapy used in this drug, trastuzumab deruxtecan, which is also known as Enhertu. So that's one difference, is that it has a different type of chemotherapy attached to it. And the other kind of interesting difference, at least it's interesting to me, is that it has what's called bystander effect. And what I mean by that is that and this is even sillier cartoon because I'm not very good at this. So what happens is, just like TDM1, in HER2 binds to the HER2 on the cancer cell and gets brought inside the cancer cell, and it releases its chemotherapy. That's the little dots here. But unlike TDM1, this chemotherapy molecule is very, what we call it, permeable. It can go through the membrane of the cancer cell, and TDM1s doesn't. So now, even though this is inside the cancer cell, it can diffuse out. So not only can it kill that cancer cell that it was originally targeted, but it can diffuse out and kill a neighboring cancer cell. And as you may realize, these little red dots now don't have antibodies attached to it. So they're not HER2 specific anymore. So even if this blue cancer cell doesn't have any HER2 on it or has very little HER2 on it, it can still be killed by this, what we call bystander effect. And say, well, why is that important? Well, it turns out that some HER2 positive cancer cells or some HER2 positive cancers aren't uniformly HER2 positive. They have a mixture of HER2 positive cells and HER2 negative cells or HER2 lower expressing cells. We call that heterogeneity. And we recently did a trial at Dana-Farber where we really wanted to kind of dig into this question, whether this heterogeneity thing really matters. And so we looked at patients who had HER2 positive cancer. And you can imagine that if they have a heterogeneous cancer, and here the blue cells are the HER2 positive cells and the red cells are the mixture that are HER2 negative, and you treat with a very HER2 targeted therapy, let's say TDM1, you can kill the HER2 positive cells, but you might leave behind the HER2 negative cells. So that was our concern, was that if you had this heterogeneity, this mixture of cells, that maybe a drug like TDM1 wouldn't be quite as effective. And so we did a trial. Patients were kind enough to join a trial where we they had, this was not patients with metastatic disease, these were patients with newly diagnosed cancers in their breast. And before they started treatment, we did a biopsy of two different areas of their cancer to look to see whether the cancer cells all had HER2 or whether they were heterogeneous. And we treated them with TDM1 and pertuzumab, the two, you know, very HER2-directed therapies. And then they had their surgery, and we looked at how much cancer was left. And what we saw was that the cancers that did not have heterogeneity, meaning that all the cancer cells were HER2 positive, 55% of those patients had their cancers completely eradicated by the TDM1 and pertuzumab. But when we looked at the cancers that had heterogeneity, that were a mixture of HER2 positive and HER2 negative cells, none of those cancers had what we call a complete response. So it really does suggest that this heterogeneity thing exists, and that it may be a little bit of an obstacle for drugs that are purely HER2 targeted, but maybe with a bystander effect, we don't see, you know, you can overcome that. And so that's what one of the things that makes trastuzumab deruxtecan or HER2 kind of unique is that it may work in cancers that have this more mixed level of HER2. And so this drug was tested in patients who had had HER2 positive metastatic disease and or whose cancer has already progressed on TDM1. And this is a different way of showing the results, but we call this a waterfall plot. And each little blue line is how an individual patient's cancer responded. And the black line across the middle is no change. And anything below that black line is cancer shrinkage. And anything above the line is the cancer growing. And you can see here that 97% of patients had their cancer either shrink substantially or at least stop growing. And only a couple percent of patients had their cancer were growing despite the trastuzumab deruxtecan. So it looked like in this study that this drug worked in virtually everybody to some extent, which again is consistent with this idea that even if patients have heterogeneous cancers, this drug could still work. So this was, a real exciting development and led to the approval of HER2 a few years ago. And we just, it does have a little bit more side effects than TDM1. So it does have more of the common chemotherapy type side effects. Nausea is pretty common. So we definitely use anti-nausea medicines, which work, but you do have to take the anti-nausea medicines for most people. Some people can have hair loss. And importantly, about 10% or a little bit more than 10% of patients have some inflammation in their lungs that requires treatment. And that was quite serious, actually, in this first trial, but we've gotten better at managing that. But it's definitely a serious side effect of trastuzumab deruxtecan that you have to pay attention to when you're using this drug. But that first trial I showed you looked at patients who had previously had T-DM1, their cancer developed resistance, and then they got the Enhertu. Just a few weeks ago, we saw the results of a new trial that looked at patients who hadn't had T-DM1 and actually compared trastuzumab, deruxtecan, and HER2 versus T-DM1 to see which one was better. And the results were pretty unequivocal that Enhertu was substantially more effective than T-DM1. In fact, it controlled patients' cancer 3 times longer than T-DM1, 25 months on average with Enhertu. So this does look, you know, this was very encouraging results, and likely in the next few months, trastuzumab deruxtecan will become the standard drug to use in patients whose cancer has progressed after trastuzumab and pertuzumab, and we would then use T-DM1 later. So that's a big change that just happened in the last few weeks. Now, the last point we wanted to talk about in terms of treatment was the fact that brain metastases are pretty common in patients with HER2-positive metastatic breast cancer. So this is a challenge in treating this kind of cancer. And fortunately, radiation is very effective at treating brain metastases, but some people's cancers can grow after radiation, you know, months or years later. And in the past, drug therapies like trastuzumab haven't been as effective at treating brain metastases as they are for treating cancers in other areas of the body, partly because the brain has a membrane around it that kind of prevents, to some extent, drugs like trastuzumab and T-DM1 from getting into the brain as well as we would like. So there's been a lot of work done in trying to figure out better ways to treat brain metastases. And I'll just go back to our original cartoon where you see that HER2, you know, sends these signals into the cell with these lightning bolts, and trastuzumab binds to the outside of the cell to block that. There's other drugs, one of which is called tucatinib, which bind to the inside of the cell and block that signaling in a different way. And these drugs get into the brain much better than drugs like trastuzumab. And so there's been a trial that was done last year that looked at the combination of chemotherapy and trastuzumab and tested whether adding this new pill called tucatinib helps. And it turns out it does have big benefits. It improves survival about 40%. And in patients who had brain metastases, it improves survival by 50%. So really a big improvement. And we were all very happy to have a drug like this, which can work well in patients who have brain metastases. There are some side effects, partly due to the chemotherapy that's used in this combination, but partly due to tucatinib, and those include diarrhea and rash, which, you know, again, are usually pretty manageable, but can be bothersome. So I will turn it back over to Heather to talk about some questions that we think that are important to answer in HER2-positive disease. And then we'll turn it over to find out what questions you guys think are important.
Thanks, Tom.
Yeah.
Next slide, please. So these are just some questions we think are important. And one, as Ian's alluded to, is why do most tumors, not all, but most tumors eventually develop resistance to a particular treatment? Next slide. And how do we develop better treatments for metastatic HER2-positive breast cancer? These are both sort of related. There's been a lot of important and impressive work, but we want to continue to do better. Next slide, please. And then importantly, how can we better treat brain metastases and help, because there can be a problem in HER2-positive disease. Next slide. And then can some patients, and this is a newer question that one we're starting to think about and hope to answer, is can some patients have long-term disease control off of treatment? And I'll show you a study that's hopefully will be opening in the next few months to get at that. Next slide, please. So one project that many of you may be part of and is here at Dana-Farber called Profile, that helps to answer this start to answer some of these questions is towards precision cancer medicine. And the goals of this project are to, and this is to get genomic information on all the patients who come to Dana-Farber, Brigham and Boston Children's for cancer-related care. And the goals are to collect genomic information on all patients who have cancer, presumed to have cancer, and are at risk for developing cancer. And in our group, we've really focused on patients with metastatic breast cancer. And then to return clinically relevant results to providers and patients to help guide clinical decision-making, to store those results so that others can also do research and to help develop important therapies, and to enable the linkage of the specimens that are collected, the tissue that's collected, back to the clinical database. And these, actually, the numbers are significantly more than this. I just got an update that we have around more than 50,000 patients have consented to this done called OncoPanel, and that there are more than 12,000 tests that have been performed. Next slide, please. And this is done in here. It's a study that's led by our colleague, Nick Wagley, the Center for Cancer Precision Medicine, Metastatic Breast Cancer Study, looking at using samples that patients kindly donate from both blood and tissue to both do clinical decision-making tests, such as ER, PR, and HER2, but also the targeted sequencing that I talked about called OncoPanel. The other tissue and blood that's left over is used for important research to understand metastatic breast cancer and to help direct additional therapies. The blood, or sometimes called liquid biopsies, is part of the program that I've been working on quite a lot. And you can actually even use some of the cells that are taken to make cell line models or even mouse models that can help us better be able to study metastatic breast cancer in the lab to additionally develop new therapies and also do molecular studies and banking. Next slide. So circulating tumor DNA or ctDNA, sometimes sort of also lumped into a group of things called liquid biopsy, is a newer tool that we're starting to use now in the clinic and also for research purposes too. But we know that it's always, and patients know much better than we do, but that metastatic biopsies can be very challenging. So getting a sample of a tumor requires taking a needle and finding a piece of the tumor. And then there can be all sorts of things that go along with that that make it hard. But getting a tube of blood is a lot easier. We know that cancer and also normal cells shed some of their DNA into the blood, and that we can then, using next generation sequencing, sequence that DNA and identify markers of drug sensitivity or resistance in a cancer. And we're already using these tests in patients with metastatic breast cancer in the clinic to help identify potential therapies. And we've also been working on a research project that's nearing completion in HER2-positive metastatic breast cancer to identify ways that cancer cells become resistant to HER2-directed therapies. Next slide, please. And so I just sort of talked about this, so I'll skip this slide. But I think this is something I'm really, really excited about and just wanted to talk through this. So I alluded to this before, but you know, we know that as we've seen how effective these therapies for anti-HER2 therapies in patients with metastatic breast cancer have been. And we know that there are some patients who seem to be on their therapies for a very long time, and sometimes on the order of many, many years. And so we ask, and patients ask, you know, can we stop? Is it safe to stop? What will happen if I stop? Some patients do stop therapy, but there's never been a study where we've looked at, is it safe to stop? What can predict who might be able to safely stop their therapy? And so we're very excited about this. It's a small study of about 80 patients, but patients who have, and this is work that I'm leading and that's supported by a grant from the from both the National Institutes of Health and also Komen, but looking at patients with HER2-positive metastatic breast cancer who've been on their therapy and not had any changes in their cancer for at least 3 years, and who are interested in stopping their therapy. And this is a decision that would be made together with their provider. And if they do want to stop their therapy, they would then stop and be followed closely and also have liquid biopsy tests done every 3 months to see whether the cancer remains controlled, to see if we can detect the patients and identify patients who could safely stop. And we'll be following patients for quite a long time. We'll be, if patients did experience progression, they would restart their therapy, and we'd be following those patients as well. But we're really excited to get this study started, and we'll be planning to do it through here at Dana-Farber, but also more broadly through the TBCRC, which is a group of other cancer centers that are also working to develop breast cancer related therapies. Next slide. So I think the sum of this is all that, you know, how can we do better here? How can we get more therapies that will be more effective? We really emphasize that all of these therapies that have been developed have been done together with patients participating in clinical trials. Really, none of the advances in breast cancer could have happened without patients volunteering. None of these therapies that we've talked about today. Clinical trials are available for patients at any step of their breast cancer journey. They're part of, we think of them as part of the continuum of care and consider them at every step of a patient of receiving treatment. And there are a lot of benefits to being on a trial. You get a larger treatment team. I think they're quite an attentive treatment team. Possible exposure to cutting edge therapies before they're available just regularly, commercially. And you're also, I think, an important altruistic point is that you're helping other patients with breast cancer to be able to get these in the future. Next slide, please. So overall, just some take home points that we are really excited about where the state of care for patients with HER2-positive metastatic breast cancer. There are many effective agents to treat this disease now and agents that are effective and with low toxicity. There are many new drugs that have just been approved and several additional ones in clinical trials. And really none of these advances could have happened without patients volunteering to be in trials. So thank you to all of you who have done that. And we wanna stop there, I think, and take some questions.
Yes.
Okay, thank you both. This is great. We heard a lot of really good information today. I'll start off with a question regarding, can we expect a cancer vaccine to be available for HER2-positive metastatic breast cancer patients?
Ian, do you want to take that one?
Yeah, so the idea of a cancer vaccine is that, you know, it's a little, just so everybody's on the same page, it's, you know, the idea is it's not so much to prevent prevent the cancer like a flu vaccine is supposed to prevent the flu. The idea is to try to use the vaccine to increase the immune response, a patient's own immune response against the cancer. And it's a really interesting idea. And there's been a lot of work done in trying to develop HER2 vaccines and actually vaccines against a number of other cancers. So far, they haven't been very successful. There's only one vaccine, I think, that I know of that's had any benefit, and that's been in prostate cancer, and it's not a great drug. But there's a lot of work being done, and there's a whole lot of work being done on just immune therapies in general, meaning therapies to try to get your immune system to attack the cancer more effectively. And that's still going on. But you know, so far in HER2-positive breast cancer, it hasn't panned out yet. And the vaccines, I think, are even further behind in terms of hints of effectiveness. So it's a good question. Definitely people are working on it, but nothing so far that would say that they're gonna be a success, but still working on it. And yeah. Just several people have asked questions. I'm responding to some of them by typing. So you can look there if you ask a question. I've already responded to some of them, but.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. We've had a number of questions come in on what therapies can cross the blood-brain barrier, specifically T-DM1 and HER2, but I didn't know if you wanted to touch on maybe what drugs might be able to pass through the blood-brain barrier.
So there, you know, T-DM1, it initially is this thought that it wouldn't pass through the blood-brain barrier because it seems like it would be too big. But it actually has been, there's evidence that it does seem to does help to treat patients with brain metastases. And so seems to be effective there. The exciting study that was done was that Ian talked about a little bit was with tucatinib, which allowed many more patients who had brain metastases on the study that led to its approval. And it's a smaller molecule and does pass through the blood-brain barrier. The blood-brain barrier isn't as closed as it is in patients with cancer that's in the brain as it is in other situations where there's no cancer in the brain. And so some of the studies that describe how things get into the brain, it's a little bit harder to figure out. But trastuzumab deruxtecan also we're starting to understand that and trying to study whether one of our colleagues who's running the program today, Dr. Nancy Lin, has been working on understanding the efficacy of trastuzumab deruxtecan and HER2 in patients with brain metastases. So there are a lot of options, but we're always working on improving those as well.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'll switch gears a little bit to cardiotoxicity. Why does HER2-directed therapy affect the heart function? And it sounds like heart function is a heart damage from Herceptin is pretty rare, and it's not typically cumulative. Is that true?
Yeah, so it is fortunately rare. The reason it happens in some people is because there turns out there actually is a little bit of HER2 on the heart muscle cells themselves. They don't drive the heart muscle cells like they do in cancer. So blocking that little bit doesn't seem to bother anything for most people, but in rare cases, it can cause heart damage. It does not appear to be cumulative. So you can, people can be on HER2 therapies for year after year and they don't get an increased risk of having cardiac problems. So it is, again, something that we all pay attention to. It could happen with any of the HER2 directed therapies, but fortunately it's quite rare. It's not cumulative. And even if it happens, it's often reversible and people can still get HER2 therapies afterwards. Whenever people do have problems with their heart, we send them to a special cardiologist who works with our patients. I don't know if that's available all over the country, but at Dana-Farber, we have special cardiologists who can help figure out ways to continue to use these HER2 therapies in these patients. But fortunately, again, it's quite rare.
Okay, thanks, Ryan. A lot of other questions have come in about resistance. So on average, how long do patients stay on a treatment before resistance happens? And is there any average data, I guess, for Herceptin and how long patients stay on Herceptin in general before resistance happens?
So it depends the average time that somebody might stay on the same therapy before resistance happens depends on which therapy it is. So, and how many prior therapies somebody has already had, as well as the particular person's cancer. But the average, the first treatment that most patients with metastatic HER2-positive breast cancer have is the combination of Perjeta and Herceptin together with the chemotherapy. And then usually the chemotherapy is stopped after a few months of it. And the average time of that is about 3 years, about 18 months. But there are about on that study, that initial study that was done, about 20% of patients seem to be able to stay on it for quite a long time, for actually many years. But that was about 20% of patients. So It can vary. I think that, again, depending on those different kinds of factors.
Okay. Thank you, Heather. Mm-hmm. This question came in, why do patients change status, meaning going from ER positive to ER negative or HER2 positive to HER2 negative over the course of their treatment? And if this happens, how do we treat that change?
That's a very good question. It does happen that patients have cancers that seem to change from one subtype to another. It's not very common, but it definitely happens. And that's one reason why we often do biopsies of patients' cancers when they have recurrences and when they have progressions to see if the subtype has changed. For the most part, HER2 positive cancers don't tend to lose their HER2 because, again, it's what's driving the cells growing, but it can happen. It's more common that they gain the HER2. So again, it's just more reason why biopsies are important. One reason it could happen is this thing that we talked about earlier, which is this heterogeneity issue, meaning that the cancer can be a little bit of a mixture of one type of cell and another type of cell mixed together. And so if you, over time, one type of cell can predominate, and that's one way that you can see this change in receptors is just there's one type that's now more common than the other, and that's what you see when you do the biopsy. But the general idea is it doesn't happen very often, but that's why it's important to do a biopsy just to make sure the receptors are the same as what you thought they were.
Great, thank you so much. This question is in regards to NHER2. Is there a concern when somebody already has cancer in their lungs that this might exacerbate an inflammation like a pneumonitis if you know somebody already has cancer in the lung and you want to use NHER2?
So that's a very good question. Fortunately, we do not seem, in the data that we have so far, we don't seem to see an increased risk of inflammation, which is, as Christine said, is what we call pneumonitis. We don't seem to see more pneumonitis in patients who have cancer in their lungs than patients who don't. So it's okay to use ENHERTU in patients who have cancer in their lungs as well as anywhere else. The important thing about the pneumonitis is just that everybody's aware that it could happen, so that if a patient has symptoms like shortness of breath or cough, that they let their doctor know or let their treating team know so that we can do an x-ray or a CAT scan to look for this pneumonitis and get you on treatment. So that's the key thing. It's just everybody's aware that it could happen so that we can figure it out if it's going on and treat it appropriately.
Okay, thank you so much. What is the difference between Herceptin and Kanjinti? If somebody's treatment was changed from one to the other, is there a difference and does it matter?
Heather, you can do it.
Is that the
one of the biosimilars?
The biosimilars. Yeah. Okay, sorry, I never know the names of the biosimilars. So the biosimilars, it's a very good question. There actually have been some very rigorous studies done to look at whether the biosimilars. So for to make sure everyone knows what we're sort of speaking about, it was drugs, brand name drugs. Usually, there's a very regulated process that brand name drugs go from being just the brand name manufacturer to then generic manufacturers, where the FDA is making sure that they're safe and the same as the initial drug. Initially, there was worry that monoclonal antibody drugs, which are much more complicated to make, could be more difficulty with going from a brand name to a generic drug. But there then have been studies now looking at the biosimilars for trastuzumab or Herceptin to make sure that they are the same as trastuzumab and as effective, and they are indeed. And so the good thing about having other generics is that the price of these drugs, which has historically been very, very expensive, can be lower, although that's been not as much as we were hoping for, but that they do seem to be the same and to be just as safe and effective as trastuzumab as Herceptin. So
great. Thank you so much, Heather. I know that's always confusing, I think.
Yeah.
And maybe Heather, you want to touch on this. When do we expect ctDNA to be available for prime time, in helping identify metastatic disease?
So there's different ways that ctDNA can be used, and we don't have time to talk about all those different things today, but we already are using it on a regular basis in the clinic to do one specific thing, which is to find changes in the ctDNA in the genome from the cancer that say that a cancer might be more sensitive to a particular kind of treatment or resistant to a particular kind of treatment. And so we look at we use that test on a fairly regular basis. There are a number of different companies that make those tests, and they're pretty easy to just draw a couple of tubes of blood, send them to the company that does the testing, and then receive those results usually in about a week if everything goes according to plan. I think what the question is about is whether we're going to be able to look for metastatic disease before it becomes widely metastatic in the blood from patients who've already had curative intent treatment. And that is something that is being studied heavily right now, but the studies are just really getting going, and we are not using it on a regular basis in the clinic. There is a test that's available, but I recommend against using it right now unless somebody's part of a clinical trial, because we don't yet know what the answer for the test means, and we don't know how to interpret those results. And so actually can be kind of a really challenging to know what to do with that result if we get it. But I think that they're coming quite quickly, and we're working hard to get those to patients, but they're clinical trials.
Thank you.
Sure.
And I was supposed to give the 5-minute warning a couple of minutes ago, so we have a few more minutes. Let me just see. Is there, with long-term progression-free survival, what studies are happening regarding extending treatment from every 3 weeks to every 4 weeks or longer? Regarding the half-life of drugs, this person is asking if the half-life of drugs is usually 4 weeks or more. So are there any studies going on in terms of extending treatment out and in terms of survival?
Yeah, Heather, I don't know if any studies that are looking at longer than 3-week duration. It is true, and just to be clear, everybody, we're talking about drugs like Herceptin and Perjeta, not drugs like tucatinib or tamoxifen. So not the pills, but the antibodies do last a long time in the blood. So you can't, that's why you can use them every 3 weeks and not like every day. But it's generally thought that every 3 weeks makes sure that it's working effectively. It's probably true that you could get away with every 4 weeks, but there were some people in whom you might lose some effectiveness. So as far as I know, there's not a lot of work being done on looking at more than every 3 weeks. One thing that has been done is changing from an intravenous form of Herceptin and Perjeta to what we call a subcutaneous, meaning an injection under the skin. And that's now available. The big advantage is you don't need an IV, and it's much quicker than giving it as an IV. So that is an advantage. It's still though every 3 weeks. So I know it gets to be a hassle to come in all that frequently, but the subcutaneous formulation is an advantage in terms of convenience for many people. So it's something that you could ask about.
I think, and real quick, someone asked about the TBCRC study that I referred to, if that will be available just at Dana-Farber or at other sites. And our hope is that it will be available at a number of sites across the country, but the details are still to come.
Thank you. And I think we have time for maybe one more question. This is an interesting question. Are resistance patterns different in patients that have had a complete pathologic response? I'm assuming if they've had neoadjuvant treatment for their initial diagnosis. if there's any data on resistance patterns in those patients.
Okay. When I said we wanted hard questions, I didn't really mean, okay, let's get the softballs back. You know, the thing that we do know very clearly is that people who have a pathologic complete response, and that when just what we mean by that is that when you know, people with newly diagnosed cancer in their breast get chemotherapy or Herceptin, or that the cancer at the time of surgery completely goes away. That's what we call a pathologic complete response. We do know that people who have a PCR do tend to have substantially fewer recurrences in general than patients who don't have a PCR. In terms of distribution or sites of metastases after PCR versus non-PCR, I don't know of any strong data about that. I have this weird recollection in my head that maybe brain metastases can still happen, but I that very well may be wrong. So don't quote me on that. As far as I know, I don't remember seeing any good data saying that the distribution of metastases is much different with PCR than patients who don't have a PCR and have a recurrence. Heather, I don't know, or Christine, I don't know if you guys know any different. Very good question.
Yeah, thank you.
I think we have to end, unfortunately. I'm sorry if we didn't get to everyone's questions. But thank you all for participating in our session today. I hope you learned a lot. We did get a lot of good information. Thank you, Ian and Heather, for all of your information, for answering all of these questions. And the recording of the sessions will be posted on the DFCI Embrace Metastatic Breast Cancer webpage. So again, I thank you all for participating.
Thanks, everybody. It's good
talking to you. Thanks, everybody. Good seeing you, hopefully in person next year.
I know, right? Thank you.
Yeah.
Bye.